Let's get things in perspective. Honest crooks commit the crime, get caught, do the time. Dishonest crooks, the vet establishment, poison millions of pets, poison the minds of thousands of vet students, then take a bow and say there should be more of it.
Hello, I'm Tom Lonsdale, old vet and long-time whistleblower. Back in 1991, Brett Muir and I blew the whistle on the Junk Pet Food Veterinary Alliance. I wrote an article in the Sydney University Vet Newsletter.
The stench of stale blood, dung and pus emanating from the mouths of so many of my patients has finally provoked this eruption of dissent. The sheer numbers passing through the practice when extrapolated to the world situation tells me that oral disease is the source of the greatest intractable pain and discomfort experienced by our companion animals. This is a great and mindless cruelty we visit upon our animals from the whelping box to the grave. Just imagine having a mouth ulcer or toothache for a lifetime. Breck managed to get a letter published by the Australian Veterinary Association.
The pet food situation has concerned me for some years. Here we have the perfectly engineered commercial circle. A problem doesn't exist, so we create one and then come up with all the remedial treatments. The infiltration of the commercial pet foods into our lives is one of the great success stories of the business world.
The AVA kept faith with their paymasters in the same edition. Far-fetched claims. The suggestion that the pet food industry has somehow engineered the problem of dental care so that someone else can develop a market is far-fetched to say the least. Our experience is that vets are not led by the nose, nor do they accept advertising claims at face value.
Against the odds, we kept up the letter writing for 18 months until the Vet Association banned all further correspondence on diet and disease. I tried giving a presentation to Sydney vets and academics from the university.
Well, my tortoise is entitled Pandemic of Periodontal Disease, a Malodorous Condition. There's a pandemic out there, 80% plus of the pets that we see in our small animal clinics are affected by periodontal disease. What to do? Well, doctor, heal thyself. As I said in that first control and therapy article a long time ago, we've got to fix up ourselves. We've got to change our perception of what's going on. And quoting from JFK there, it's good, isn't it? If you're not part of the answer, you're part of the problem, and I feel that's the way we've been. Okay, all these folks have got something to answer for, and they've all got to change their game. And it's in the notes. And what can we expect? Well, providing it goes through, according to our experience in our little practice out in Western Sydney, things will be simply bloody marvellous.
Mars Corporation spokeswoman, Dr. Barbara Fougere, issued a veiled threat.
People that don't know me, I'm Barbara Fougere, I'm a veterinarian for Uncle Ben's.
I must say, I admire your bravery for sharing your opinion.
What retribution did they have in mind, I wondered.
Getting me investigated by the government disciplinary board seemed to be part of the strategy.
Keeping in mind, of course, the disciplinary board is stacked with Australian Veterinary Association nominees beholden to Mars, Nestle and Colgate-Palmolive. Over the ensuing years, against gathering opposition, I researched, wrote and promoted the fundamental need for the safest, most powerful, most gentle, most effective food and medicine for pet carnivores, raw meaty bones.
During the 20,000 odd years that dogs have been our companions, we've bred them to whatever shape and size took our fancy, even if that shape was impractical or downright unhealthy. Cats, on the other hand, have largely retained the shape natural selection gave them. But when it comes to eating, both our carnivorous companions are more used to answering a tap on the tin than dining the way their wild cousins always have, on raw meat off the bone with a little of the hide on the side. Sydney vet Tom Lonsdale believes it's through that very change of diet that today's pet lovers are condemning their carnivorous companions to a life of ill health and misery.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time.
In one corner, commercial pet food, and a market worth $700 million a year.
There's a good boy.
In the other, raw meaty bones, and cheap as chips.
There's a handful of people deriving a big quid out of flogging artificial pet food substances to an unsuspecting public.
And he says it's not just Fido who benefits from an almost exclusive diet of flesh and bone.
It's a lot cheaper, incidentally, to feed them on the natural food anyway. So even the food costs come down to about a third, and your veterinary bills disappear.
Dr. Tom Lonsdale certainly seems to have ruffled a few feathers in the veterinary profession. And his heresy seems to be you shouldn't believe everything that vets tell you. But Tom doesn't just stop at bones. He claims his profession is in the pay of the multinational pet food companies. He also believes the commercial product causes an AIDS-like condition in cats and dogs.
An acquired immune deficiency syndrome where he'd lost an immense amount of weight, his liver was playing up, and he was just a listless, sick animal.
His claim that dogs with severe dental disease fed commercial food have very low white cell counts and therefore are immunodeficient is fallacious on a number of grounds.
Dr. Jill Madison is a specialist in small animal medicine and lecturer at Sydney University.
So you don't believe that commercial food is necessarily bad for animals or damaging their health?
No, I don't. And in fact, I think that good quality commercial food has improved the nutritional basis of our pets over the last 20 years.
Tom's aggressive campaigning by post, media and email has got him into trouble with his peers. The Veterinary Surgeons Investigating Committee of New South Wales is now probing an alleged breach of professional conduct.
Some in the profession refer to you as Loony Tom. Are you loony?
Well, to a degree I'd have to say possibly yes, to put up with all this sort of personal taunts and jibes.
Well, are you saying that the whole of the profession is in the pay of the multinational food manufacturers?
Yes, wittingly or unwittingly. It varies for different individuals. Some know full well and some actually are on the payroll of the multinational pet food manufacturers.
I myself am a consultant for Frisky's Pet Care.
Australian Veterinary Association refused to discuss Dr. Tom on camera. Reality now bites for Dr. Lonsdale. He faces possible disciplinary action. His critics say he's literally like a dog with a bone who won't let go.
For 20 years, I practiced in the opposite mode. I did as the processed pet food manufacturers would have us do. I did as my teachers at the university told me to do, and the results were dismal. I guess I was able to compare the before and the after, and that's what makes me fairly well sure we've got the right answer.
Denied a voice in vet journals, I tried running for president of the Australian Veterinary Association as a means to getting the word out just once a year. 10% of Australian vets supported the call for investigation into the junk pet food fraud. But the authorities were unmoved, instead bringing several more disciplinary actions against me and finally excommunicating me from the Australian Veterinary Association. Lawyer and MP Paul Lynch spoke in Parliament.
The whistleblower was punished. This is the action of a kangaroo court. It is a disgrace. How can the Minister for Primary Industries continue to place reliance upon a group such as the AVA? In days of yore, frock-coated barber surgeons washed their hands after the surgery, when they needed to clean off the blood.
Back then, they had ignorance as a defence, and in any case, only a minority needed major surgery. Nowadays, the smiling vet delivers certain disease and debilitation to all of his patients, courtesy of the junk food sold by the mass poisoners. And pleading ignorance does not save them.
Google the terms junk food diet, inflammation, dental disease, obesity, heart attack, stroke. The evidence is everywhere, inescapable and compelling, except for vets.
Serial whistleblowing against those that make and maintain the laws, the conceited and the hypocrites, does not work. But blow the whistle we must. I quit the day job to write books and tour the world on speaking engagements. Standing for election to the Royal College of Veterinary Surgeons Council seemed worthwhile.
It's an opportunity to put 500 well-chosen words before 23,000 UK registered vets. 2015 marked the 19th year of standing, growing old and coming last every year for 19 years. This year, 11 candidates each made video appeals for votes. This is mine.
Hello, I'm Tom Lonsdale, asking for help. Help stop the mass poisoning of pets by vets. Question: what is the number one priority for the RCVS? For many years, the veterinary elite has enjoyed a comfortable ride on the back of the junk pet food Trojan horse. Junk food poisoning of pets is the worldwide norm, thanks to veterinary protection for the economic colonialists Mars, Nestle and Colgate Palmolive. Poisons, harmful chemicals, impair health and bring about premature death. Harmful ingredients, predominantly starch, in most junk pet foods. Harmful texture, leading to stinking periodontal disease and toxins flooding the body. Harmful texture that just simply does not clean the teeth. Add in junk food induced obesity and you've got a woeful situation afflicting most pets from the day they cut their teeth and for the rest of their tortured lives. The Royal College of Veterinary Surgeons, hitherto a major part of the problem, should fix this scandal as a first priority. In my view, as a first step, the RCVS should consider withdrawing the accreditation from veterinary schools that brainwash their students with junk pet food propaganda. See Sydney University Veterinary School extolling the alleged benefits of Hill's junk food. The Royal Veterinary College, University of London, working with Nestle Purina. Liverpool University Veterinary School working with the Mars Corporation, Royal Canin. University of Queensland collaborating with Hill's, a division of Colgate-Palmolive. In last year's RCVS elections, 432 vets voted for legal action against prominent companies, veterinary institutions and individuals in respect to breach of contract, animal cruelty, theft and deception. Every vote counts. Thanks for your help.
The Royal College advised, "Dear Tom, the registrar has asked me to inform you that we cannot publish your video as it stands. If you would like to submit another video, please do so as soon as possible. Thank you, Ian."
Sound effects mark the excision of the censored passages. Junk food poisoning of pets is the worldwide norm, thanks to veterinary protection for the economic colonialists. Let's have a look at some of the veterinary science informing the everyday decisions of vets. Here's the 24 years after first blowing the whistle, we're still not allowed to mention the names of the guilty. And alas, the videos failed to garner extra votes, and of course the establishment failed to deal with the allegations.
Back in Australia, the fight continues. Freedom of information applications into the junk pet food grease and slime permeating seven vet schools rolls on. Vet schools sell access to their students and thus sell them into servitude for Hill's, a division of Colgate-Palmolive. The multi-billion dollar Mars family buys a slice of the action too. Hill's call their packaged junk science diet. We called our Facebook video science death, showing the effects on four dogs consuming the veterinarian recommended junk for just 8 days.
So we've long known that little dogs suffering a rotten mouth and a toxic diet can rebound in health and vitality quite quickly if we pull out the bad teeth and change the diet. But this got us thinking, how quickly will healthy dogs start to deteriorate if we feed them junk food? So we found four volunteers. First off, we start with Pippa. She's 6 years of age, a little poodle cross dog, and a delightful little creature. Next comes Molly. She's a three-year-old border collie. She belongs to one of the staff here. The next in line is Shenzi, an Australian coolie. He's 2 years of age. And then lastly, We've got Doze, he's a Mastiff Cross, and he's just 18 months of age. 17 days ago, Chenzi, Doze, Pippa and Molly joined us in what we think is a significant little pilot scheme. Prior to that, they were all fed raw meaty bones. Their teeth and gums were pristine, they were filled with vitality, their breaths were fragrant, their poos were the right shape and size. That was the start of this experiment, and we fed them for 17 days out of this sack. Let's see what became of them. We started off, they were all of them raw meaty bones fed dogs. Their still images show just the wonderful pearly whites. Within 8 days, you can see dramatic change in Doze's teeth. And then now, 17 days on, all of the four participants in the trial have stinky breath, yellow teeth, sore and bleeding gums. And 17 days later, three of them have lost weight, one has gained weight. But all of them have lost vitality. All of them have got behavioural changes. A couple of them are scratching, their skin irritates. Their poos, of course, have swollen in size and stench and runniness. Pippa's a little one. She's hardly eaten her food throughout the period. She treats it with utter disdain. The images of the teeth, of course, are a significant telltale. Don't forget that these animals cut their teeth at 3 weeks of age, and from 3 weeks they're supposed to brush their teeth every day. Our dogs did, until they commenced this trial. And then for 17 days, they ate junk food and didn't brush their teeth. And this, of course, is where the bacteria are travelling. Because they haven't been scrubbed away by the appropriate food, the bacteria have multiplied. And they're now gaining access to these dogs' mouths and from the mouth to the rest of the body. So for 17 days, this is the fake food that our volunteers have been consuming. But right now, we can go and see them enjoy their first real meal after 17 days of this experiment. So the volunteers get to end their ordeal with a first meal of frozen chicken carcass. So just watch them, how they use each of their teeth in different ways, how they flip the carcass from side to side, how they rip and tear and give the best workout you can possibly get for the teeth and gums. What does this do? Well, of course, it's equivalent of brushing and flossing and squeegeeing all in one go. And of course, the salivary juices are flowing too, bringing antibodies and cleaning to that crevice between the tooth and the gums. And that's where all the bacteria have been hiding, but no more. They're now going to get scrubbed out of there, and we will start to see a considerable improvement in the health of the teeth and also the gums in the coming days. Stay tuned.
Bearing in mind, dogs and cats can't speak about their pain, suffering in silence through lifelong torture. We made a video to show the Mars devastation. You may need to avert your eyes.
Okay, Sydney University, we made a short film for you and your mates in the junk pet food industry. We know that you've got deals with the Mars Corporation, makers of the junk food you see to the left. You've got deals with Colgate-Palmolive, the makers of so-called science diet. The consequences of feeding junk food to pet cats and dogs and ferrets is just catastrophic. But according to you, you're not prepared to change because you're not prepared to be the conscience of the veterinary profession. We need to do something about this. We invite you to start reconsidering your strategies. But right now, let's go over to see young, or not so young, Wally Muir, who was one of the victims of the junk pet food cult.
Wally was 8 when you came to see me back in 2013. And of course, not able to speak, he couldn't complain about how he was feeling. Tell us what happened the day you came home.
I came home, my wife said to have a look at him, and went at the back and had a look at him. You could smell him, smell his breath. And he had like pretty much the size of half an apple on the side of his jaw coming out, where it was all an infection. And yeah, he just didn't want to get up. Normally comes running over to me, but wouldn't do anything. Yeah, made a few phone calls, and the girl on the front counter said that, yeah, they could bring him down and see him. So kid's wife said bye to him, because I honestly didn't think he'd be coming home, and we got down here, and yeah, that's when you took care of him.
When we took the little fella in, examined him, examined his teeth, and then set to and remove, well, we were going to remove such bad ones as we found that every one needed to come out.
Yep. Poor little dog. All the way around that mouth.
Have a look here.
Okay, so the probe is right through between the roots of that tube. Okay, and then the same will apply to this one here. Look, can almost just lift it out. And this one similarly. And then this one here, massive. And notice the little dog flinch. Can you see the flinch? Mm-hmm. Even though he's under anaesthetic, he's feeling that. All right, look at that, see? You notice? Right, so that's excruciating pain every minute of every hour of every day. And then down here, similarly, encrusted, look at that, right? What we call furcation. Tooth ready to just be lifted out. And then these here, look. Mm-hmm. Extraordinary, isn't that? See? Courtesy of junk food and veterinary incompetence. Have a look at this one here. Look at that, see? Extraordinary, isn't it? How the little dog could endure that and continue to wag its tail, you'd have to wonder.
Alas, our videos are but a small drop in the bucket when up against the combined forces of the Pet Food Industry Association of Australia in partnership with the federal government, the RSPCA, and the Australian Veterinary Association.
Pet food safety is very important to Australian pet owners and veterinarians. The Australian Veterinary Association, along with the Pet Food Industry Association of Australia, work together to develop the Australian standard for the manufacturing and marketing of pet food. And the Australian Veterinary Association is really pleased to have contributed to the implementation of this new standard.
The standard was developed by an expert working group that included representatives from the Australian Government's Department of Agriculture, state governments, the Australian Veterinary Association, the Pet Food Industry Association of Australia, and the RSPCA.
Christopher Pyne MP, Minister for Education, he'll help. He'll understand that the whole rotten, callous mess starts at the top. I wrote to him.
Sydney University's so-called educational and scientific contracts entered into with the junk pet food makers amount to criminal conspiracy in breach of numerous acts and regulations, including, but not limited to, Sydney University Charter of Academic Freedom, Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, Veterinary Practice Act, Truth in Advertising Regulations, Laws of Obligation, Deception and Fraud, Breach of Contract, Education Services for Overseas Students Act 2000, Tertiary Education Quality and Standards Agency Act 2011. He replied, "You may like to direct your complaint to the University of Sydney. Yours sincerely, Christopher Pyne, MP."
Looking on the bright side, Dr. Richard Malik took a principled stand on Radio National.
Richard Malik is a veterinary specialist at the University of Sydney. He's also one of the world's most respected and well-known feline veterinarians. And Richard, I take it from this conversation that you don't have a great relationship with some of the bigger pet food distributors and manufacturers.
Oh, I think it would be fair to say that they would rather that I be dead.
Well, I'm not sure they'd go that far. But
I actually think they would.
Really?
Yes, and I've had many arguments with them, and they're a very powerful machine.